Thank you, Amos. Good morning to one and all. This is Dr. Suresh from TIT. Let me introduce our guest speaker, Professor Dr. V. Sandhanam. He is from Rajalakshmi Engineering College. He has completed his bachelor's degree from Tantai Boreal Institute of Technology. He has completed his master's degree, CAD, ME CAD, from University of Madras, and doctorate from Anna University in the year 2015. He has around 18 years of experience in teaching. He has published around 25 national and international journals. He has some consultancy projects to his credit also. See, he is a renowned professor and has a vast experience. His field of interest is fine attainment analysis and composites. So he is with us to explain about the fine attainment analysis today. Let us get his experience and learn from his expertise. Thank you.
Thank you, Suresh sir. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Welcome, sir.
Okay. So, Professor Sandhanam,
shall we start, sir?
Yes, sir. You can start the session.
Thank you, sir. Once again, a warm welcome to all of you. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Murugan for inviting me to this FTTP on finite element analysis and its applications in engineering. Briefly, let me switch off my video to save the bandwidth. Okay. This presentation, I would like to give you in three, just wanted to split into three categories. First off, we will discuss about mathematical modeling purely from mathematics point of view. There is no FEA in the first part. And the second part, finite element analysis using software, what kind of problems we may encounter. And then we will have a case study. I would like to acknowledge whatever the material I am presenting here, mostly they are taken from various internet resources and my gurus and of course my students. Students are also kind of gurus only. They only make us to learn day by day. So introduction to finite element analysis. Hope all of you might have gone to all these basics. So it is a computational scheme to solve field problems in engineering and science. So field problem may vary from structural to thermal to even electromagnetic also. And of course, fluid mechanics, everywhere finite element is there. In fact, one of the person have told that even the entire human body can be completely modeled into finite element analysis. If you take the entire structural integrity of human body, including the bones, you can model, including the material properties of bones and the tissues, you will be able to model. Likewise, if I want to compute the blood flow, so how the blood flows through our veins, even the micro tubes inside our body, so that can also be modeled, and how the temperature varies in our body. So for each and every aspect, it is possible to completely model entire human body using finite element analysis. But of course, these things already you might have seen, but why do we need a finite element analysis? What is the need for analysis? So in this case, we need to have a small background analysis of physical versus virtual prototype. In fact, everyone knows the usage of prototype. A prototype refers to the physical model or physical replica of an object. It can be a machine element or a structural building, whatever it is. So what we do is, this prototype can be used for different purposes. One of the purpose is to analyze its functional capability, and another purpose is for showcasing, like what people have the prototype for buildings. Architectural planners, they used to have a prototype, but that prototype is meant only for visual appealing. The buyer wanted to see how his future house may look. So that is one type of prototype. But another prototype, which is primarily used in industries, was physical prototype, which is used to test the functional capabilities. Functional capabilities means the prototype will be subjected to the similar environment of real-time exposure. So whatever the loads and whatever the boundary conditions, so all those things will be imposed on the prototype, physical prototype, and we will have the sensors like strain gauges and thermometers, everything you will have. And finally, we will get the data, and we will be able to analyze the data. By that, we will be able to find out which is the weakest point, how can we modify the design. But unfortunately, this physical prototype takes months to analyze. In fact, if I want to make a small dimensional change, and again, I have to repeat the same thing, making of the prototype and subjecting it to real-time environment. So it takes huge amount of cost as well as time. So then only people have thought about mathematical modeling, representation of physical equations, and then solving those mathematical equations by using computers. But when computers are there, computer can speak only into zeros and ones. It doesn't know anything about equations, like a partial differential equation, nothing it knows. It knows only zeros and ones. So how are we going to convert the real-time system into zeros and ones? That is where the finite element analysis and the software comes into play. So this we would call it as virtual prototype. And the advantage of virtual prototype, just like that, we will be able to change the dimension as well as loads, whatever you want. You can change material if you want, you can change. And then you will be able to get the answer. But still, usage of FEA, usage of software, doesn't guarantee our design is safe. All it needs is the fundamental knowledge about the design engineering, basic understanding, conceptual understanding is required. So let's briefly discuss about mathematics. So overview of finite element method, I hope already these things are discussed. Strong form, we convert into weak form, and then we convert into, try to solve weak form by using Galerkin approximation method, and then this is converted into matrix format. So can anyone tell me what is this strong form? Strong form refers to the partial differential equation. Am I right? The governing equation is called as strong form. So governing equation might be of second order or fourth order. In case of vibrations, usually we deal with the fourth order. So it is of higher order partial differential equation. And that one we convert into weak form. So weak form refers to you are going to reduce the requirement of approximation equation. Approximating equation, usually we go for some polynomial. Polynomial like x square plus x plus 1. So those kind of polynomials we go for approximation. So in order to make use of lower order polynomial, we convert the strong form into weak form by using method of separations. And then this weak form can be solved by using several approaches like point collocation. There are several methods available, but one of the most popular and most widely used method which gives lesser error is Galerkin approach. Again, while using Galerkin approach, we get lot of equations. As we know, a set of equations can be converted into a matrix form. So this is the actual path of finite element analysis from pure mathematics to pure matrix. So this matrix can be implemented for solving in computers. Yeah, of course, we have those five methods. They are called as method of weighted residuals. And there are other approaches like variational formulation also used, where we consider minimization of potential energy. So now, first part, we will discuss about mathematics. So how mathematics is helpful in our real life, understand the importance of mathematics in engineering, how real-time physical systems are modeled into mathematical equations. So we will have a look at this. So now you are able to see a cup of coffee, right? So this cup of coffee, everyday life, we are using it, we are seeing this thing. But this cup of coffee is represented using a mathematical equation. So this numbers and alphabets in the blackboard completely represents this coffee. So instead of photograph, if you look at this equation, you may have to recognize, okay, this equation represents some hot or cold liquid in a cup like that. The real-time physical system can be modeled into a equation. Likewise, the real-time system where people are sitting on this chair, this can be represented using a mathematical equation. So how are we doing that? Yeah, there are several examples. Air circulation through ceiling fans, this how it is circulating, how it is flowing, drying of cloth, even day-to-day life, daily life, we are encountering these kind of situations. So how is it possible to represent this thing into mathematical form? And always remember that whatever we are capable of representing in mathematical form, that can be converted into finite element formulation. So here also this two-wheeler shock absorber, this can be modeled into a mathematical equation. Of course, temperature variations in dosa. I know it's lunchtime. So what happens is the physical system, whatever the photograph we have seen, it is the actual physical system that is converted into mathematical model. So set of equations, and how we are converting into an equation, that depends on different concepts like equilibrium equation or conservation of energy, conservation of momentum, conservation of mass. So like that, we can make use of several principles and then convert into mathematical model. And this mathematical model, we can have two types of solution. Either you can directly solve or indirectly solve. So indirect method to solve is by using finite element method. And then, of course, we have final physical interpretation. So again, let us look at this picture. So the cup of coffee, if I want to find out how much time it takes to cool up to a certain temperature, let us imagine that our mother is giving the cup of coffee at high temperature directly from the stove, right? Maybe around 65 or 70 degrees Celsius. but I want to sip this coffee at a little bit lower temperature. So how much time it will take from 65 up to 55? So if I want to measure, we need experimental method. So that method will consume time as well as it will take some cost, because I need to purchase thermometers and all. And also I have to experimentally measure the drop of each and every degree Celsius. But there is another solution. We can make use of mathematical modeling also. So what happens, this is the actual physical system, and the real system can be represented in the diagrammatic form. In case of engineering mechanics or structural, we call this diagrammatic form as free body diagram. So where we represent all the forces as well as the constraints. So here the surrounding also specified, whatever the surrounding parameters, that is also specified, because everyone knows that during winter season, the coffee will cool faster. During summer season, it may take some more time. Or if I switch off the fan, if I switch on the ceiling fan, it may cool faster. So all those parameters we are representing. And then we make use of governing equation. That is, here in our case, conservation of energy or the heat transfer that is being considered. So using that, and of course this formula you can see, this one, Newton's, based on Newton's law of cooling. So we are able to get this equation. So how we are getting this equation, in fact it might be already discussed in basics of FEA, while we are deriving the elemental equations for a bar element as well as beam element, for thermal element we start from this only. Am I right? So
yes sir, yes sir.
So we formulate this equation. So here the actual flow of solution goes like this. Real time problem is converted into partial differential equation or ordinary differential equation, and the solution is obtained in this format. This is actually the exact solution for this particular equation, and this particular equation corresponds to this actual scenario. This equation, everyone will be able to check. We can visualize also. But anyway, this particular part is a deviation from finite element methods. So this part is obtained by using, in fact, everyone knows that if I want to solve a differential equation, I have to go for particular integral plus complementary function. This is what we have studied in mathematics. So particular integral plus complementary function, or by integration, by pure integration, you are able to get this equation. And if I am plotting this equation, I am getting this particular solution. So in x, y axis, I am able to plot the line. So this line shows the variation of temperature with respect to time. So here on x axis, I have got time, and y axis, I have got temperature T. So initially the temperature is higher, and after certain time, it is dropping. And after that, the temperature doesn't vary. Why? Because the cup of coffee had attained equilibrium with the surrounding. So this is what the actual solution for the real life problem. So this we consider as virtual modeling or virtual prototype. Because instead of coffee, if there is a juice, simply we have to change the parameters, and we will be getting different kind of plot for different density, for different viscosity. So different kind of thermal coefficients, we will be able to get different plots for different materials for different scenarios, winter or summer. So this is the advantage of converting real life problem into mathematics. But unfortunately, every problem cannot be easily represented using this kind of mathematical equation. So what do we need is for complex problems, like for a house. So in this case, lot of parameters involved, lot of constraints are there, lot of loads are there. So in these cases, a simple equation may not sufficient. So what we are doing is, we are trying to approximate, we are trying to find the solution of this equation using a simple polynomial equation. Instead of y of x equal to 30 into e power minus 0.25x, what we are doing is y equal to, simply put, mx plus c. I am assuming this as the answer. So this answer surely will get some, will produce some error. So that error, if I am minimizing, so over the domain, I am going to minimize that error. So that equation is being used for small, small elements, for small, small portion, and then it is getting combined all together to get the final equation. So this is where the basic of FEA starts. And the equation what I had used to obtain this one is from this website, Wolfram Alpha. So in that website, they have a tool where you will be able to give some differential equations, and the tool will calculate the final solution, and that solution you will be able to get the plot also. So we are able to get differential equations, which is known as governing equation, and we are able to get governing equations based on several principles. So here some of them are shown for mechanical systems, for electrical, electronic systems. Mechanical systems include structural, thermal, and fluid flow, everything. And here we have got electromagnetic flow. So another case study, or another example, how mathematical modeling is useful in representing this fellow, that is this stool. So again, what we do is the real-time system is converted into the picture format, that is the free body diagram, and again same thing along with the loads and the constraints. Of course, this equation already might have been discussed. So we take an infinitesimal or small element, and we draw the force equilibrium, consider the force equilibrium, and we consider constitutive matrix, strain displacement. So all those things we consider, and finally we are able to get this equation in case of structural deformation. So this equation is what is known as governing equation for axial loaded objects. So this partial differential equation, if I am solving it, and once again for the same equation, I made use of this particular website, Wolfram Alpha. So from that only this particular plot was obtained. So it means that this plot refers to that the load and the deflection is directly proportional to each other. It means that if 70 kg, 700 newton person is sitting, you may get shortened by 0.01. So if it is 35 kg person, it may be 0.005. So like that, it is a directional, direct proportional. So we have got again several applications for this structural, and similarly we have got how the air flows in ceiling fan, through ceiling fan. So the physical system is represented in pictorial format, and again this one is represented into like this. So how the air flows, what are all the input parameters, what are all the output parameters, like output velocity, direction, so everything we consider, streamlines, and then we are able to get this governing equation. So this governing equation is based on the momentum conservation, mass conservation, of course energy conservation. So we take all these things into consideration and we solve. So unlike previous examples, this example, it is difficult to get the solution directly using a mathematical calculator. So the only way is we have to input, we have to convert this one into finite element modeling. And once again, finite element modeling analysis doesn't mean ANSYS software alone. If we know how the equation is written, if we know how to split the equation, then we will be able to write the coding, our own coding, in MATLAB also. MATLAB is also one of the finite element tool. In fact, it's a multi-purpose tool. We can make use of it for finite element analysis also. So drying of cloth, here we got mass conservation, mass balance of water in air, energy balance. So using all those things, again we are able to get some solution, and the plot also obtained for different wind velocities, 0.5, 1.0, 1.5, we are able to get. And this one, so what kind of analysis is maybe required for shock absorber? So the shock absorber needs analysis of vibration. So this equation represents the vibration equation. So in this equation, the total mass of the vibrating system, and then damping coefficients, and then the spring stiffness, whatever is used. So everything we consider. And this one, F naught sine omega t, represents the external excitation. So when the road is bumpy like this, each and every second, the vehicle wheel is subjected to some kind of variation in displacement. So that is what is given here. So for forced vibration, we consider this term. So this one, for equal to zero, means it is free vibration. So we consider all these things, and then we find out at what frequency input, how much excitation, how much displacement we will be able to get out of the shock absorber. For example, if the tire is moving over a bumpy road, the bumpy road, maybe it is having, say, 5 centimeters of bump. 5 centimeters of bump, it is frequently, that is continuously, it is experiencing. But the bump may be 5 centimeters, but the person sitting over here, he may get the vibration to the amount of 10 centimeters also. That's what we call as frequency response. So for some input frequency, for some input displacement, what kind of response the entire system is giving. So in this case, we will be able to decide some kind of modifications with respect to the spring stiffness, modification with respect to the damping. After changing that, how I'm able to minimize the vibration response, that also we can study. Of course, we have got dynamic analysis. And likewise, we can have a lot of examples everywhere. In whatever we discussed, they are all we encounter in our daily life only. So everywhere surrounding us, we have everything which can be modeled in a mathematical format. So whatever you are able to represent in mathematical format, that can be converted into finite element format. So here, what kind of laws we are using? Some basic differential equations. Anyway, you can just Google it. You will be able to get for different kind of situations how differential equations are obtained. And this is with respect to the torsional vibration. So every day we are using this kind of beater, egg beater. So how much torque is acting? So based on this torque equation, torsional equation, if we are solving, we will be able to find not only angle of twist, the response, the stresses induced. So pumping of water. So this is a brief introduction about mathematical modeling of real life systems. Hope you are able to understand, and in fact, this is not only for the faculty members. This can be told to the students also. Even though this is slightly a deviation from finite element analysis, many of our students think that finite element analysis means solving something using only the computer, that is ANSYS. But it is not like that. Solving a problem using ANSYS or any other software requires a basic knowledge of what is what they are solving. So basic behavior of all those systems. In fact, many of us might have encountered our students are solving a problem for 4 or 5 pages, finding a diameter of the shaft. For 2 HP motor, they will solve and they will give the final answer in terms of 5 × 10^5 meters. And even they don't bother about verifying whether that answer is practically possible, whether it is a valid answer, nobody thinks. And some of our students also give the answer like 5 × 10^-6 meters. So both ends people are giving answer because it is not only numbers, numerals or alphabets, they are all a real life system. People are dealing with the actual things surrounding us. So unless we appreciate the usage of mathematical modeling, I think this is the first step into FEA. Okay, anyway, we will move on to the next phase. So using software, finite element analysis, so what are all the errors or what is the brief introduction? Hope I am not repeating the content, what is already discussed.
Yes, sir, it is not a repetition, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir.
We can proceed.
Okay, sir. Once again, let me briefly come out of this presentation. Okay, hope you are able to see the screen now.
Yes, sir.
Before proceeding with this presentation, let me show something else. So here you are able to see a chair, plastic chair.
In fact,
this was given as a task to me by my former HOD, thanks to Professor P.S. Rajeswaran. He asked me to model the plastic chair, whatever we are using in our office, the same plastic chair, Neil Kamal. He asked me to model it and analyze it, why some of the plastic chairs are failing. So this was modeled by reverse engineering. So here you are able to see each and every detail. The entire chair was modeled by reverse engineering. Every day I used to go to my home and take the plastic chair, measure each and every part, and then I started from scratch, from zero, started and drawn this. And then I try to model it as much as possible to my knowledge and to my effort. I stopped with this because after this, I just wanted to know how this particular thing is behaving in ANSYS environment, that is in analysis. So this plastic chair, I just converted into IGES format. And for time being, I had imported this into ANSYS software. Hope you were able to see. Just before starting our session, by around 11:30, I just imported this chair into ANSYS environment. I started to mesh it. So, and it is showing some error. Of course. I think I have to come back to the error, then only I think it may finish. Okay, anyway, what I'm trying to tell is, this chair, after meshing, what I obtained is only the bottom seat I was able to see. Remaining portions were cut off. Can anyone tell? Hope some of you might have done this, might have experienced this. I was able to get only the bottom portion, only the seating portion was retained in ANSYS software. Other features like this handle and the vertical legs and the back support, they are all gone in ANSYS. So after some research, I found that is because of the approximation error or the elemental error, or we would say the conversion error, conversion from CAD software into ANSYS. So with this background, let me proceed with software part of FEA. So as everyone knows, we have got pre-processing, solving, and post-processing. So in pre-processing, what do? We define geometry, and then we define type of modeling, and then we give material properties, and then we mesh, and then boundary can impose boundary conditions, and then solution. So solving is taken care by the system, and we have got post processing also. Okay, anyway, before proceeding, in earlier days we had if analysis, then by default everyone thinks only ANSYS. So ANSYS was just like Xerox. So how Xerox is only the company name, but those people have converted the copying process. So everyone, instead of talking about copying, everyone talks Xerox like that. ANSYS is synonymous with analysis, FEA. But that was a long time back. Nowadays, due to the advancements in computing power, due to the RAM capacity, processor capacity, most of the softwares, they have implemented analysis capability, they have integrated analysis capability into their software itself. In fact, Autodesk was meant to be popular only for AutoCAD in earlier days, but now AutoCAD simulation is also there. Autodesk also into simulation. So we have got meshing, So meshing is nothing but creating elements through the solver. And one of the wrong notion is, if I simply give finite mesh at the area of interest, I will be able to get better result. But that is not in all the cases. For example, in this case, even though at the point of interest the meshing size is small, here we are able to look at some of the irregular shaped mesh, also irregular shaped elements. So one of the key point with respect to meshing is about aspect ratio. So aspect ratio is also important. So a mesh having a triangular mesh having two sides much larger than the third side, so this may produce a little bit skewed result, unexpected result. So instead of blindly going on with the mesh refinement, we have to do mesh refinement in a gradual manner like this. So we have got beam elements, triangular surface elements, and the tetrahedral solid elements. And again, if we look at the software capabilities, initially ANSYS had only this particular interface. So this one. Oh. So ANSYS had only this particular interface. But later on, APDL, this one is known as APDL, but later on they considered workbench, also introduced workbench. So workbench, we need not have all those difficulties using this window. In fact, if we try to compare, this window may be considered or analogous to the DOS operating system in earlier days. So where we don't have any mouse, we don't have any window, nothing was there. Only a black colored command prompt. Using that only, everything was run. But due to the advancements with computing technology and computing power, instead of trying to simplify all those models, we are simplifying everything only because of the computing requirements. But nowadays, since computing requirements are already higher, most of the softwares directly go for, by default, they mesh in using solid elements, tetrahedral elements or brick elements. But mostly they make use of tetrahedral elements only. So different type of elements, beam elements. Of course, beam element is only a rough approximation of the actual system. In reality, no object is one-dimensional or two-dimensional. Even a paper has got its own thickness. So nothing is 1D or 2D. It's only an imagination. It's only an approximation. But anyway, we were fine with those kind of approximations because they were able to give a closer answer to the actual result. So plate and shell modeling. Again, these are all surface or 2D elements. And then we had 3D elements. But as I told, nowadays, most of the softwares, they make use of 3D elements by default, unless otherwise we change the element type. So what kind of consideration we need to give for CAD modeling. So while doing CAD modeling, always we need to ensure the continuity of the surface. So continuity of surface must be ensured, not like this. So here you are able to see lot of openings, lot of places where there is discontinuity. So these things, they lead to meshing error. I think the ANSYS window closed on its own. Yes, it was not able to process, so it closed on its own. So CAD modeling is the important phase of finite element analysis. So it is always better to go for direct 3D modeling integrated with what to say analysis software. So it is important to have clean geometry without any other complex features like sweep or holes. Wherever possible, we can avoid those things. Yes, so this kind of features where two fillets are merging at this point, in CAD model we may not have any problem, but in ANSYS model surely this will create some problem in meshing. So these are all the problems where most of the industry people encounter. So what they do is they make use of third party meshing software like HyperMesh. So they go to individual element by element, they try to attach those elements, they try to clean and clear those elements by manually selecting them. So inclusion of fillet, chamfers, wherever there is some kind of complex curvature involved, variable sweep, so those things we may avoid for getting proper analysis result. So for part simplifications, so these are all the points we may have to consider. So some of the features, they may be required for representational purpose only, but that particular feature may not have a functional importance. So functional wise, it may not have a load bearing capacity, or it may not be used in, it may not be subjected to huge amount of stresses. So those features we can neglect. Yeah, so here we can experiment with this also. Like if I am adding a fillet, whether the part is able to get meshed properly or whether it is producing any error. So if it is producing some error, and if it is the must requirement for the functionality of the component, then we may have to go for cleaning the mesh or cleaning the elements. Otherwise, we can simply go for without meshing. So these are all some of the considerations which we may have to consider while doing CAD modeling and analysis. And of course, one more point is to try to use the same CAD system for all components in design. So, and we have got different standards also, IGES, DXF, or VDA, or Parasolid. So in CATIA, we will be able to import, we will be able to export using Parasolid also, X underscore T, some format will be there. And then visually inspect the quality of imported geometry. So sometimes what may happen is the imported geometry, it will not be fully imported. Only part of the geometry drawn geometry will be imported. But in our case, in the ANSYS window, what we have seen, we were able to see the entire part was imported. We can experiment with some other format also. Yeah, avoid modification. That is, even though it is perfectly possible to modify a model in SolidWorks, which was modeled using CATIA or Creo, that is usually advised to avoid. So, lot of concerns while transferring using a neutral file format. So, material properties. So, pre-processing involves not only modeling, proper modeling is required, and then assignment of proper material properties. In fact, no CAD system or analysis system recognizes steel or mild steel or cast iron or plastic. It doesn't know anything. What it knows is only the yield stress or ultimate stress, Young's modulus, and Poisson's ratio. So these are all the most important aspects which the system makes use of in solving the matrix. So we know that finite element analysis involves solving the matrix format. So in the matrix format, it needs some numbers. So it recognizes only those numbers, not the materials. But some of the CAD systems, they have already incorporated those materials into their database. So it is easier for us, instead of remembering all these values, it will be easier for us to simply pick and assign those materials to the required component. And of course, we have non-linear analysis also. So why do we need a non-linear analysis? Because in reality, most of the materials, not even most, almost all the materials behave only in non-linear fashion. They behave in linear fashion only up to a certain amount of load. For example, if I am taking a simple spring, a normal spring, we have got spring constant. So like this, a spring is there. The spring is subjected to some amount of load. Say if I am giving 1 kilogram, if it deflects 1 millimeter, then if we ask our student, for 2 kilogram, how much it will deflect? People may say 2 millimeters. So this is what is linear response or linear material property. But it doesn't mean that if I am adding 100 kilogram, what will happen? 100 kilogram, the entire spring might have got straightened out. It might have got straightened out. So even if I keep on adding, say 500 kilogram, it will not elongate. So up to certain load only, it is exhibiting linear response or linear material property. Thereafter, the load is not directly proportional to the deflection. It varies. So that is non-linear. So in reality, wherever large deflections are involved, they are all non-linear. Wherever we have got plastic deformations, they are all non-linear. So even in softwares, they have got material properties which can be assigned in non-linear method also. So non-linear response of the materials can also be given as input. So apart from material property, we have got boundary conditions also. So the most important part of analysis is all about proper boundary condition and proper loading. So that involves understanding of the actual problem, understanding of the real-time scenario. So for that, basic of engineering design, strength of materials, thermal engineering, so those that particular knowledge is required. So boundary condition involve loads as well as constraints. So in boundary condition, we have linear dynamic and then non-linear. So how do boundary conditions are usually specified by making use of degree of freedoms? So in case of fixed support, all the 6 degrees of freedom are arrested. Pin support, otherwise known as hinged support, it allows only one rotation, which means that remaining 5 movements are arrested. Roller support, so roller, we can move to and fro as well as we can rotate, so both are permissible. So over constrained model, that also we can avoid. So here one simple example is given, but anyway, this thing is taken from internet resource. So here it was said that while giving constraint to the 4 points where the chair legs are joining with the bottom plate, so proper constraint must be given. So this is the summary of pre-processing. And then solving. And of course, in solving also, there are few algorithms, few solvers. They are being used by different software people. And then post-processing. So after solving, I need to check the results. So how much deflection it has got, how much displacement or the stress it has got. So those things can be checked. And also we will be able to get the animation also, animation of displacement or animation of model analysis. So how the object vibrates, those things we will be able to get through post-processing. So after post-processing, we need to check whether the answer given by ANSYS is realistic. Is it possible like that? We need to analyze. And again, it is only up to the engineer to make use of his knowledge, his experience to check the answer, whether the answer is expected or unexpected. If the answer is unexpected, if the results are too huge or too minimal, then there may be some problem with the modeling, meshing, application of constraints. So everything is involved. So sources of error, so discretization, formulation, and numerical errors. So we have got a lot of errors. Just like we discussed, maybe due to poor modeling, or it may be because of poor element choice, or even during meshing, aspect ratio of the element might be erratic, or even application of load and the constraints might not be realistic. So all these things we need to consider. These are all the errors we get in finite element analysis in softwares. And of course, we have got advantages and disadvantages of FEA. So let us discuss a small case study. So here, before that, let me go to once again. So here we have got a project where the project involved analysis of a trailer. Let me rotate this. So here, hope this is visible to all of you. There was a need from the company which involved analysis of this particular trailer, this particular platform. We were required to analyze because they had purchased this trailer from German. So, and the total length of this trailer, it is around 113 feet, 113 feet length. So this particular trailer, after importing, they need to get certificate from an educational institution, and we are required to give certification that this trailer is safe to use for playing on roads. So this is specifically used to transport this windmill blades. I think most of you might have seen this trail, this kind of trailers. So this particular chassis part, we were required to do analysis. So they have sent the diagrams, they had sent the pictures, and what we have done is we have gone through their stock yard, their place, ourselves, two faculty members, along with a few students. We went there, and then we measured each and every part of this chassis. So after measuring, we have modeled in SolidWorks software. So this is the part. Hope this is visible. So this part was modeled in SolidWorks software. Since we are doing complete modeling, ANSYS was not feasible. It's because modeling in ANSYS requires a lot of effort. Since we had a little bit time, we modeled using SolidWorks software. So here you can see. So this involves this cross member, and then a longitudinal box section. So here you are seeing one cross member and then axial, that is longitudinal member. And here two box kind of structures are there for reinforcement. So this entire platform, this entire chassis was modeled and then it was analyzed in ANSYS. It was analyzed in SolidWorks itself, SolidWorks simulation. They have got SolidWorks simulation. So here you can see the constraints and loads. So the bottom one represent the support with the suspension system. So here we have got the suspension system. So since the entire chassis is firmly fixed, it was given as fixed support, fixed geometry. And here we have got the value of the entire blade. The total load of the blade was imposed over here at two places. And this one represents the self weight of the entire system. So this was modeled and then meshed. Of course, the meshing is taken care by the software itself. There is no need to mention specifically any kind of elements, since by default it is modeled using 3D elements. So finally, we were able to get the stress plot. So stress plot, usually we get, usually we go for von Mises stress. Any reason why we go for von Mises stress? Here the material is mild steel. So von Mises stress is generally used for this carbon steel. So here you can see the material assigned is carbon steel from the library, materials library. So this stress analysis, we were able to get maximum stress induced was around 101, and yield strength of the material was around 3 4, 5. So we were able to get a factor of safety of around 3.5 also. So here, factor of safety is we are able to get the plot on factor of safety also. So how much factor of safety individual part is having. So the lowest factor of safety is what is our concern. It is what we need to worry about. Under the lowest factor of safety, we get around 3.41, which is heavily stressed area. But still, based on the input from the company, it was within the safer limit. So finally, we certified that the entire chassis is safer to transport this particular load. That's what was our report. And of course, apart from that, we had given design calculation also. We had given the manual calculation also. And manual calculation, as you know, that it involves rude simplification of the actual design. We could not consider all those fillets, all those holes, all those ribs. These things we cannot consider. But anyway, we had supported the software using this manual calculation also. So under manual calculation, we were able to get a factor of safety of 11.57, and the entire chassis was assumed as beam. So, but that is what the company required. But we have taken it slightly further away. We tried to change the dimensions, experimented with the dimensions, tried to find out what is the implication of change in dimension. So if we are, is it possible to reduce the thickness of all those supporting elements? Of course, let me skip all those things, basics. So this was the specification of 113 feet trailer given by them, given by the company. 105, two trailers were involved. So CAD model was built. And then all those boundary conditions were imposed. So these are the boundary conditions imposed. So at these 2 points, two supports, and another 2 points, external load, and over here, self weight, and stress analysis report, displacement report. So here we are able to see that the displacement is around maximum displacement is 29 mm, which is 3 centimeters, and which is within the permissible limits. For a load of this much, that is around 27 tons, and for a length of 32 meters, 3 centimeters deflection is completely permissible. And then we moved on with by changing the material, so by generating holes. So here on the top surface, holes were generated. And we checked whether it is exceeding the permissible stress or not. So here again, the stress is within the limits. Displacement is also within the reasonable limit. And the factor of safety also we were able to get around 3.3. So like this, design modification was performed on this truck by reducing the material, which otherwise is impossible in real-time environment using a real-time prototype. So this is what was further carried out. So circular holes were also introduced on this side frame, as you can see over here. And anyway, we did not see any huge variation in these stress as well as displacement, because these portions were already less stressed part. So we found out what are all the parts subjected to less amount of stress. So we tried to remove material from those less stressed parts and then analyzed again, and we have got the satisfactory results. And of course, we can extend the analysis even with dynamic behavior also, how it vibrates under normal road conditions, what is the deflection during vibration, that is forced vibration. So those things, whether the vibration is coinciding with the natural frequency of entire chassis, that can be analyzed. But anyway, that was not the scope, so we stopped with that. Okay, thank you. So any doubts for discussion? I think I have completed a little bit earlier.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful session.
Thank you, sir.
Participants, if you have any doubts and clarification, you can unmute yourself and discuss with the guest.
Anyway, whether I know or not, if anybody is asking doubts, I will be able to learn. After all, it's a continuous learning from our side.
Yes, sir. Yes. Teachers are permanent students.
Yes, sure, sir. And I know very well that it is exactly lunchtime. That also, I understand. And there was no interaction also. Only I talked.
Yes. So in the this is online mode, sir.
Yes, sir. That's one of the drawbacks.
You have to.
If it is offline session, means there could be more interaction.
Yes.
There
yes.
could be more questions. In fact.
Yes. And always face to face contact is very important.
Yes, sir.
So you have given basics of FEA and mathematical modeling, and also you have shown one important case study also.
Yes,
I think this case study may be given as a PG level project, sir.
Yes, sir. In fact, it was given as the PG level project only, sir.
Yes.
We had extended that project. Consultancy project we had completed. After that, we gave that project to one of the PG students for optimizing the chassis dimension.
Dimensions. Okay, sir. Okay. Amo, sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank you.
Sandhanam sir.
Sir.
Yes sir. Thank you sir. Thank you very much.
Thank
you
you,
can leave
sir.
the meeting. Yes sir. Sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you sir. Thank you.
Thank you for all the participants.
Thanks.